Hello, Facebook Live. Peter Mansbridge here with David Frum. Familiar face, especially for us in the last year, but also around the world. We're doing a lot of commentary and a lot of different networks, and obviously the Atlantic, where David's a senior editor. The topic for today is about, well, what else? About the Trump presidency and the interesting things that are going on there. So we're looking for your questions quickly to situate you. We're on the fourth floor of the National Newsroom here in Toronto. That's the resources area behind me, the place where the men and women of the resources team bring in feeds from around the country and around the world. Okay, while we wait for those first questions, I know there are going to be lots of them. You know, a couple of days ago, before the Flynn resignation, I heard David Gergen, who you know well, worked for four presidents, commentator a lot, on, especially on CNN, saying that what, and once again, this is before Flynn, saying what Trump had managed to do in the first 3 weeks was normalize shock. In other words, every day there was some kind of shock, but it almost became normal. This, though, isn't just shock. It's bigger than shock.
This is a convulsion. But it's not clear, by the way, that he won't be able to contain it, but sequence of events. So Monday is the Pierre Trudeau visit to Washington.
I'm glad you did that, too, because I did the same thing.
What was that?
Justin Trudeau.
I beg your pardon. Oh, my gosh. Yeah, that's the decrepitude. Okay. It's always the more real. Look, I once met the great singer and humanitarian Bono. And right. I kept calling him, sorry, Bono. And I kept calling him Bono, which it turned out was the worst thing you could do, because it implied that, in your mind, Sonny Bono was a bigger star. And so, and this was explained to me, I said, what do you mean? Sonny Bono isn't a bigger star? Okay. So the Justin Trudeau visit, so that's Monday. And you very astutely observed that Trump seemed to be kind of depleted that day. Not his usual full of vim self.
Right.
That night at 11 o'clock, news breaks that General Flynn, the National Security Advisor, has resigned. And then we learn more and more about why. And we are now, and that has been followed up with the latest revelation, and this is, I guess, 48 hours later, this morning, the New York Times broke, that people in the Trump campaign were in regular contact with people who were known to the FBI as Russian intelligence officers. That is explosive stuff.
Are they in full crisis mode in there?
They jolly well better be. they look embattled. We don't know how much time they've had to get ready for this. I mean, the news that Russia was helping the Trump campaign, that's been visible for a long time. That's been obvious since the summer of 2016. Donald Trump's own alignment with Russian foreign policy, that's been true since he entered the race in 2015. So there are a lot of secrets here, but there's no mystery. But the great overhanging question was, okay, we know that Russia was helping Trump. Did anybody at the Trump campaign talk back to the Russians? Because it's one thing to be the passive and unwitting recipient of Russian espionage intelligence, bad as that is. It's quite another if you're working with them.
The question here comes from Rob Sampara, and it's about the use of the I word, impeachment.
Yeah.
You know, we've heard that tossed around a lot over the first month. Is it any more serious now?
I think people need to take on board. You know, it's an easy thing to talk about. It really is a crisis mode. If that eventuality were to happen, we'd be talking about shutting down the United States government for 3 months, 4 months, 6 months, however long. It, you know, the Clinton crisis lasted for a year. Clinton managed to remain in many engaged because he always knew he had the votes to ward off the ultimately being removed. In a case where the president doesn't know that he's got the votes to ward it off, I mean, it would be a terrible thing for the world. There are other mechanisms, by the way, by which the president can be removed from office, including the 25th Amendment procedure, which I recommend Rob can read up about on it, but it provides for a president who's unable to discharge his duties. And it's got no sense of you did anything wrong. You're just, like Woodrow Wilson, incapacitated, and then there's a process by which the cabinet and Congress working together can remove the president.
There's also, one assumes, there are a number of levels of investigatory processes that could take place before you ever get around to something like that. And some of them are kicking in already.
Right. You have law enforcement, you can have a law enforcement investigation, led by the FBI, and that is done with warrants, and that looks at crimes. You can have a counterintelligence investigation led by CIA or other agencies, and that doesn't look at crimes, it just looks for intelligence dangers. They don't follow as many rules as the FBI because they're not actually looking to lay charges ultimately, they're just looking to shut down a security risk. You can imagine an investigation by Congress, by either House, by the House or the Senate, or you can imagine an independent investigation set up to find out what happened. And like the 9/11 investigation, mm-hmm. where somebody would look backwards at what the Russians did in the 2016 campaign.
Susan Alexandra asked this question. It kind of relates to your answer from just a moment ago. What safeguards are there in place for the U.S. From having a president elected who is mentally unfit for the presidency? Now, you know, Susan's question doesn't come out of nowhere. You had Senator Al Franken actually throw that out the other day and claiming that some of his Republican colleagues in the Senate were talking this way.
Well, that's what the political system is for. It doesn't always work. We've had some pretty unbalanced personalities, and people often get unbalanced by the office. Richard Nixon had, I think by the time he left office, some serious mental health issues. He also had some addiction issues that he took medication. I now forget what it was supposed to treat, but it was for some other condition. But this medication had the side effect of hugely magnifying the impact of alcohol on him. So Nixon, who was a drinker anyway, not an alcoholic, but someone who drank the way they drank in the late 60s, mm-hmm. Which is more than they do now, and then you take this pill with it, and having two drinks becomes like having four, having three becomes like having six, and you'd have trouble sleeping. And we've seen other people with psychological issues. Woodrow Wilson spent his last 2 years in office. He was the victim of a stroke, but it had effect on his judgment as well, pretty obviously. And the 25th Amendment was written mm-hmm. with the Wilson scenario in mind.
Okay, here's a good question from Paul Holmes. Is the center or bipartisan gone in U.S. politics?
There is no center. There was a chart I was looking at the other day which showed the percentage by which members of Congress deviated from voting with the president of their party. And it just makes this amazing gap of this, it looks like a widening V to a point, and it's now almost completely perfect, that you have party line votes on almost everything of substance. Now, the Trump administration may change that. As they say in social science, the trend is a trend until it bends. We may be about to see a change because, first, Trump departs in important ways from the traditional beliefs of the Republican Party. He obviously has no regard for the Republican Party as an institution. And he may be just enough of an outlier that people do come together and say, whatever the differences Republicans and Democrats have on many, many issues, that Donald Trump is doing things that are unacceptable. One of the things, though, let me just say something to all both these questions and the others. There is a premise here that Donald Trump is going to lose this confrontation with
which would suggest we haven't learned anything from the last 2 years.
I think people need to take seriously that it may be the intelligence agencies that lose, and that
would be a first.
Which would be a first, but at least a first in this political system.
Yeah. Right.
But he may be able to identify the sources of these leaks, retaliate against them, shut them down, shut down these investigations. That could happen too. And so I think people are underweighting his chances.
I've watched this debate play out about the leaks and watched what Trump said on his Twitter feed again, pointing at the intelligence agencies. Well, they weren't the only ones who knew about this.
Yeah.
We now know that for the last 3 weeks there've been a lot of people in the White House who knew about it.
Right.
Not the Vice President.
Right.
And a lot of those same people in the White House are at each other's throats and are leaking on each other.
Right.
So there are a number of places this could have come from.
Theoretically, if the FBI is investigating you, they're not supposed to talk to anybody about it.
Right.
Because investigations often lead to the conclusion the person under investigation did absolutely nothing wrong. So their name should not be in public as the target of an investigation. That implies that there was something. If you knew there was something wrong, you would lay charges. And even in the case of Michael Flynn, it's not clear that he broke any law. So it is disturbing to have this kind of information come into the public eye. The reason it's coming is because the people in these agencies do not trust the administration and do not trust Congress to investigate. And so they are putting things in the public domain where they can, in hope, that they that will protect them from being shut down.
All right. A lot of good questions rolling in here, so I'll try to shut up and just ask their questions. Chris Roundel, this is good. I like this. First, my politics are fundamentally polar opposite to David Frum, but I've found myself agreeing with him three or four times in the last couple of months. Can you talk about the unity of the Republican Party and the Democratic Party? Are they really divided, as some reports have stated?
Well, Democrats are always more divided than Republicans are. And first, thanks to Chris. It worries me too, Chris.
What, that Chris agrees with you?
What I say to some of my new pals on these questions is what we have to do is restore normal politics as usual, so we can go back to whacking each other over the head about the capital gains tax. The Democrats have just historically been the less united party. They represent, basically, the Republicans have always been the party, since the Civil War, have been the party of the American middle. And the Democrats have been the party of the American periphery, both geographically, the coasts, but also culturally. Basically, if you're somebody who, for one reason or another, feels uncomfortable with the mainstream of American culture, whether that was, you know, Southern whites during the time after the Civil War, whether it's Catholics when America was more Protestant, whether it's minorities, those people have tended to gravitate to the Democratic Party, and the Republican Party is the party of people who are more or less culturally comfortable with the country as it is. Those things may be changing now in the age of Trump, but that's the way it's been till now. So the Democrats have greater trouble with party unity. In the Republican Party, the issue right now is there is this divide between Republicans who are conscientiously anti-Trump, conscientiously pro-Trump, and then the larger group who are working with him either because they fear him or because they think they can achieve something and have a very instrumental relationship with him and are looking for the moment where he goes one way and they can go another.
Fassi Syed asks, what's the difference between Hillary Clinton's email scam and the Flynn scam? I guess in terms of impact and seriousness.
Well, Hillary Clinton set up a private email server while she was a State Department employee, which she shouldn't have done, and intermingled personal and public emails, which she shouldn't have done. And because her server, which was in the House at Chappaqua, had low levels, didn't have very good security, she put secrets at risk. As far as we can tell, she got away with it in the sense that no one seems to have actually hacked her server, that all the hacks were not of her server, but were of the Democratic National Committee. And then John Podesta, who's an important person in the Democratic Party, he gave away his passport for one of those phishing things. Be careful at home. Make sure your grandparents are careful. And they got John Podesta's emails. In what happened with Michael Flynn was he had conversations with the Russian ambassador about there's some dispute about this, but which pretty clearly seemed to have been a discussion about whether the incoming Trump administration, this happened before Trump was president, would lift the sanctions imposed by Obama. And the reason that is so serious is the Russians intervene in the election and help Trump. Obama puts on sanctions after the election to punish the Russians. And the Russians are trying to think, how do we react to this? Should we escalate or should we de-escalate? And at just the moment when they're making that decision, Michael Flynn has this conversation with the Russian ambassador and, it is believed, assured him that the sanctions would be taken off by the Trump administration.
Have they been?
They have not been. And Congress is now acting to put them into law, remove them from the executive and to put them into law. But understand here that this is a case of the beneficiary of a wrongful action saying to the person who committed the wrongful action, don't worry, we'll protect you. That's why it's so serious. And again, we don't know 100% that all this happened, but that's what it looks like happened.
Karen Alexandra asks, with so many things happening at once, Russia, Flynn, cabinet appointments, repeal of the ACA, possibly the EPA, how is this going to affect how journalists cover the news? You know, they just did a briefing again today, Trump selecting the American journalists, both from, not fringe news outlets, but not traditional mainstream outlets, and not getting questions to the day's news.
Well, let me pinch just a something in that question, because there's a premise there that I think is wrong, but it's wrong in a very interesting way. On the things that presidents usually do, pass laws, bills, Trump is actually not doing very much. That there's this huge uproar about all these scandals and investigations, the dysfunction of his administration, and these very heavy-handed executive orders. But, you know, we're almost a month into the administration, there is no sign of any action on healthcare. There's no sign of any action on taxes. On the party's core issues. I don't know that he signed an executive order opening the way to lifting some of the bank regulations that were put in place during the Obama years. But there's no question. There's no indication they're changing the law. They're changing some regulatory practices. So we may see a combination of frenzied activity, but actually less substantive change than you got from, say, George W. Bush.
Steve McDonald asks, what do you think isolationism, if that's the way it goes, will do to America's economy? And do you think it will impact Canada when we're clearly reaching out to globalization?
I think this is something much worse than globalization. I think that for reasons either of ideology or for some other reason that's more sinister, the Trump administration's views on how to organize the world align with those of Russia. So the Trump administration is pretty activist. They are bringing the United States closer to Russia. They are steering toward confrontation with China and Iran. They're alienating traditional friends and allies, most ominously Germany. The U.S.-German relationship has never been in more trouble since the war than it is now. First the Soviet Union and then Russia's number one foreign policy goal since 1945 has been to cut the link between the Anglo-American powers, Canada, Britain, the United States, Australia, New Zealand, and Germany. And that is a project that has never been closer to success than it is today, and that is a huge threat to the peace of Europe and the stability of the world.
Let me ask you a question as we wait for more of your questions coming in here on Facebook Live that deals with this issue of talking to the Russians before you take power, while the transition was on, even during the campaign. It's not the first time we've seen something, relatively the same as that in the States. We saw it in the when Reagan beat Carter. His people were dealing with the Iranians on the hostage situation that was going on at that time, and arranged the hostages were released the day of the transition. Nixon in 68 didn't deal directly with North Vietnam, but involved himself with South Vietnam before he was president to kind of blow up the peace process before the election, which would have seemed to have favored Hubert Humphrey, who was running for the Democrats. So the difference here is what?
Okay. First, in those two cases, both of those were hugely controversial at the time, and there are real suggestions, I think false in the case of Reagan, true in the case of Nixon, they overstepped the limits of the one president at a time rule. There is a law dating from the 18th century that forbids anyone to have any civilian to have dealings with a hostile foreign power. It's never been in much enforced, and it's hard to imagine how it can. But here's the difference in this case. There was no suggestion that the Reagan campaign was somehow receiving benefits during the election from the Iranians. There was no that all of this is happening in the context of Russia having intervened in the election through its espionage services and its cutout WikiLeaks to help Trump and therefore Flynn. So if what had happened was this, if you had people who, the Russians hadn't involved themselves, and you just had an administration that believed a close relationship with Russia was in America's best interests, and I wouldn't share that view, but I can imagine an intelligent person arguing that point, and they then had these, I would think that was really a big, big mistake, but it wouldn't be a scandal. It's a scandal because Russia helped, and this looked not like a strategic calculation by Finn, but by payback to the Russians for helping Trump in the election.
Here's one that's kind of personal for you. It seems to me that every time the people of Iran seem on the verge of making progress against the theocracy, some Western power comes in and tramples all over them. Do you ever regret having put the words "axis of evil" into George W. Bush's mouth? David, of course, was one of the main speechwriters for George Bush at that time.
Okay, there's a lot to say about that. So let me just deal with this. I have met speechwriters who are vain and foolish enough to believe that they are the boss and the president works for them. But that's a big mistake. You don't put words in a president's mouth. You suggest things he might want to say. And you try to anticipate what he would want to say. But the idea of denigrating his authority is really is ludicrous. I mean, George Bush was a person of tremendously strong will.
Let's rephrase it. Do you regret suggesting those words?
I don't. They were true. The people. One of the things that was so controversial, and the usual line of critique back in 2002 was it was absolutely impossible to imagine that Iran and Hamas were working together, because Hamas was Sunni and Iran has the theocracy there, a Shiite, and everyone knows that Sunni and Shiite Muslims could never collaborate, except they did, and the whole world now knows that. In 2002, that was kind of secret. So that suggestion that sponsors of terror work, that the key idea in that phrase was understand that these terror groups work together with state sponsors of terror, even when they didn't, when the state sponsor and the terrorist group disagreed on a lot. Al-Qaeda found a lot of refuge in Iran. Al-Qaeda was, those people were mostly Sunni, and Iran, as I said, was Shiite, and yet Iran gave protection and refuge to a lot of the Al-Qaeda terrorists after 9/11. So these are just facts that the president truthfully said. But let me go to his premise. I think Iran will make more progress toward getting rid of the theocracy and achieving democracy when people in Iran lose the habit of thinking that the reason that they haven't been successful now is because of something that somebody else did to them. There have been positive movements in Iran. They have been crushed by the Iranian state, and your quarrel is with the Iranian state, not with outside powers who have their own interests, of course, which are not the same as Iran's.
Bernadette Bradley is a journalism question. Do you think real legitimate news sources have been irreparably damaged by all the fake and misleading news sources that are now out there?
I think in media we're now a little bit like someone who needed to go buy milk before 1914. That we're in a world in which you can no longer go to the store, open the drawer, and assume that the milk is healthy. You have to be a much more discerning shopper than your parents did about news and information. And that both creates amazing opportunities. I mean, you can read more things in realer time. I can remember when it was difficult to get the same day copy of the Washington Post in New York City. So you can now read, the Straits Times, as fast as anybody in Southeast Asia. So that's an amazing opportunity. But there's also a lot more harmful junk out there. And so one of the things, when I wrote this article for The Atlantic that got a lot of attention, I ended it by talking about things that we can do to be better citizens. And one humble recommendation I make to people, never forward or Facebook anything until you have personally traced where it came from and are satisfied that it's from a reputable source. Because people are very careless about this, and we all then become republishers of false information, and we're all a little implicated.
Tell me the process in your case. Like yesterday, you put out a new piece in The Atlantic on the website. And it seemed like it had been written, because it was so topical, 5 minutes before.
Yeah.
What is the process from when you push send to your editors?
Yes. Okay, so I write both slow and quick. Because we have a print edition where things are pretty slow, and we have an online edition where we have to be quick. But we're a little slower than most people. So the process is, you're thinking about this all the time, you're immersed in it. I write pretty fast. And then you go through the checking process of, there are things you remember. Your memory is so fickle and unreliable. So you have to check. And then there are things you saw in print, and you have to trace them up. And so one thing, for example.
You're doing all that, or they're doing that?
No, I do 85% of this. So you'll see there'll be a story in the Financial Times that inflation rate was reported by whoever reports the inflation. But I will then click through and go to the government source, because the Financial Times, really respected newspaper, they make typos, same as anybody else. You have to go to the first publisher. Then I send by email to, there are a number of editors at The Atlantic who work on different topic areas. We have a particularly brilliant editor of the politics section, a man named Yoni Abibam, and he reads it over carefully, and he'll have questions. I've said something that doesn't seem to him right. He'll check the link, or he'll ask me for some corroboration or substantiation. I'll say one more thing about this, which is I work a lot through online sources because, despite my I'm the world's worst interviewer. There's some karmic justice being visited here. My mother was the world's greatest, and I'm the world's worst.
Exactly.
So after years of bringing home cassettes, as they were then, and playing, realized I talked to somebody for an hour and didn't get a single good thing. I've just given up, and I now think that the world is full of people who are good at this, and if you just follow the sources, you can find everything you need to know.
All right. Carly Marie MC asks, Who's in more trouble right now, Canada or the U.S.?
That's an interesting question. I don't know that Canada can be well if the United States is ill, that Canada depends so much on a healthy America. But
and is that's not just healthy economically. That's
no, culturally healthy, militarily healthy. I mean, Canada doesn't provide for its own security in any meaningful way. Canada, got this relatively small population sitting on top of half the world's fresh water, all this mineral wealth. There are people who'd like it, and Canada doesn't pay to defend it. It's the Americans who do that. But Canada has gotten a lot of things right, both by good design and good luck. And I'll say this about Canada. One of the things really interesting about Canada, and what it makes it a very important place to study right now, is it is one of the very rare cases of an advanced democracy that does not have a nationalist populist movement in its politics at the moment. Why is that? Partly because Canada had the fastest recovery from the Great Recession of any of the major economies, and also because when you line it up and look at the performance of the median income, the people right in the middle of the income distribution, they did better in Canada than in almost any other developed country. Germany and Australia are the main rivals, but Canadians did even better. So rapid recovery from the crash and a steady performance for the middle class, not as good as the Canadian middle class did in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, but better than anybody else is doing right now. And that has inoculated Canadians against a lot of the things you see in France or the Netherlands or the United States.
But do you think that there's some of that nipping at the edges? And, some people seem to think we see that in the Conservative leadership campaign.
Well, I think one of the things that's going to happen, the people who are trying to use those themes are going to discover that they don't work very well. And there are reasons why they don't work very well. There are reasons to be concerned. Canada takes a very high level of immigration. Immigration is destabilizing. There's reasons why you might want to have less. And there are reasons why you might want to set limit on multiculturalism and say, if you choose to come to Canada, there's certain ways Canadians behave. There's certain things Canadians do and don't do. And if you choose to come here, you play by Canadian rules. Well, I think those are reasonable things. But what you don't see here is that desire to destroy institutions. The French National Front, we want to blow up the European Union. What Donald Trump wants to do in the United States. I don't think that kind of politics plays in Canada. And I think there are reasons because Canada has felt like a successful place for the past two decades.
Where do you rank blowing up the CBC on that? A few of those. I won't go for the answer on that. Marie's Day asks, is Trump as weak as he seems?
No. He doesn't seem weak to me. He seems like he's a bad manager. We know that. We seem he's very distracted. But he is a shrewd and canny survivor, as 16 fellow Republican candidates for president can attest. And I think everyone is now, as I said this earlier, people are making big assumptions that in the struggle between Trump and the intelligence agencies, he's going to lose and they're going to win. He can fire them, and he may.
Here's an interesting one, plays out of your Article 25 question. Ian Greer asks, can Article 25 be a cascading effect? When I look at the succession tree, I think he means, I find it hard to believe that everyone in that tree, all the way to the Secretary of the Interior, didn't have some prior knowledge and participated in some covering up. I mean, they do seem to be going out of their way to say the Vice President knew nothing, we never told him anything, he's all by himself, even though pictures from some of the key days and this, he's sitting right there.
Well, the 25th Amendment has no suggestion of moral turpitude or wrongness. You're under the 25th Amendment, you're removed because you are unable to do the job. It contemplates a president who is sick. It's got in mind the Woodrow Wilson case of a president who's basically incapacitated and refuses to admit it.
Right.
And it's no coincidence, by the way, that it passed in the middle of the 1960s when people were worried about, well, what if the president goes crazy and he's got these nuclear powers? Because I don't think enough people appreciate that in the realm of nuclear policy, the president is an absolute monarch. That there are no checks on presidential authority of any kind having to do with the decision about nuclear weapons at any given moment. You need somebody who's mentally well-balanced.
Louise Waldman asks, I read with interest Mr. Frum's advice on how to protest. I think that was at the end of the autocracy.
That was something I published the next day on the online edition of The Atlantic.
I read it as someone on the left who often protests injustice. What's David's advice to those on the right who are not protesting?
Great question. One of the central ideas of that article was meetings matter more than protests. You have to be organized, and meetings are successful to the extent that people can agree on, I recommend in the article, unlimited efforts on behalf of highly limited goals. So the most successful pressure group of my adult lifetime in the United States was Mothers Against Drunk Driving, who have transformed the laws on drunk driving, transformed American manners. I mean, it's just a, if you remember what it was like before, it's incredible what it's like now.
Yeah.
If you want to be involved with Mothers Against Drunk Driving, they didn't care what your view on abortion was, or taxes, or guns, or anything else. You didn't even really have to be a mother. You didn't even have to be a woman, but if you, if you are willing to join them, they had a series of reforms that they wanted to make that made drunk driving more subject to legal punishment. And if you signed up, you were in. And they didn't talk at their meetings about anything else. So that's the approach I recommend. Now, I'm not telling people not to go to protests. I mean, it's a free country; you can do what you want. But what I'm
you could argue that protests ended the Vietnam War. That started off, everybody said, oh, this won't go anywhere, and the president at the time, Nixon, sort of said, we're the silent majority.
Yeah, you could argue that, except then you'd have to bump up against the fact that Richard Nixon won the election of 1968.
Right, and 72.
And the war became much more violent under President Richard Nixon.
Right. But he basically lied. He's 68, he said he'd end the war.
Well, but he ended it through by massively increasing the pressure on it. If you are somebody who was, it's like the monkey's paw. If you were a protester in 1968, you would not regard what happened as, if you could have had a glimpse, that would have not looked like a victory to you, to those people.
Right.
Well, Occupy Wall Street and things like that. And what happens with these protests is, especially post-Vietnam, they have 99 demands, so they don't have any. They don't police any of their fringes, so all kinds of exotic and sometimes even violent characters show up, and who are there to, there may be only 14 of them, but they capture the spotlight. That's what they're there to do. Everybody goes home afterwards and nothing has happened. The point of this is, yes, I understand that they can galvanize and empower people, but their real value is they introduce people to each other and then send them home to do the real work of politics, which is done, it's tedious, but it's done through meetings and door knocking. And I've done a lot of door knocking, I can promise you.
Dennis Sturgiotis asked this question, and I can imagine what his follow-up would be, depending on how you answered. Is David bilingual?
No.
Okay, so you're not in the race.
I also, I get that question. I've also published, I've never really tallied it, but millions of words. And anyone who's put as much in writing as I am is disqualified from holding any office, down to sitting on the Neighborhood Advisory Commission on how long the beer patio should remain open.
Okay, I'm reading these ones blind here. Edric Dudang, the Morning Joe host, who's Joe Scarborough on MSNBC, said this morning that, I think he was talking about his co-host, Mika, said this morning that she won't allow Kellyanne Conway to be on the show anymore. She says that Conway spreads misinformation, shouldn't be allowed. What are your thoughts on that?
I think it's a complicated question. Just in general, people who hold important positions in administrations are newsmakers, and you need to hear what they have to say. I do think there's something wrong with the cable TV format, where basically because a show like Morning Joe doesn't have much of a budget, that instead that you bring the newsmaker on and do talk to them face to face, rather than having reporters do the work of finding out what's really going on, and so I don't know how much value that those kinds of interviews are, but the idea that you would say, that's it, this person lied to me once too often. I mean, Sean Spicer lies all the time. He lies about the dumbest things. He lied about whether or not he has a super soaker. There he is on TV every day at lunch hour, and of course we all
do you have watch. Any problem using the lie word?
I would avoid
on describing some of the things that have happened here. And, I remember tweeting something on the day after the inauguration, because it had been over that whole thing about crowd size, and there was another issue. There was more substantive. There were two of them at the same time, where, to me, there was no question that it was a lie, both by the president and his spokesman, Spicer. But you know, there was this, you know, I got quite a bit of blowback on that about using the L word.
Yeah. Well, I think it depends on a lot of variables. One is, I understand why Gerard Baker, the editor of the Wall Street Journal, said he wouldn't use it. I understand why he didn't. I understand why you'd be cautious in a national news broadcast on a broadly watched television program. I think it's also true that with Donald Trump specifically, that oftentimes you're wondering, is this a delusion or a lie? I mean, if somebody keeps telling you he's Napoleon, he's obviously mistaken about that. but you wouldn't call him a liar. I mean, he's got a different kind of problem. So Trump and the crowd size, that may not be a lie in the way. Here's what Sean Spicer did. There was a report that after the Saturday Night Live sketch, that his staff had presented him with some Super Soakers as a gift. Brian Stelter, who does media criticism for CNN, reported this out. And Spicer tweeted at Stelter, "That's just wrong, like everything you say." And then it turned out, just today, Dylan Byers reported, and I think Politico or CNN.com, that indeed there's a Super Soaker in Spicer's office. Now, maybe Spicer would say, if you ask him about this, "Well, your initial report said I'd been presented with several, and indeed there was only one." I think I'd be real, if I were him, the idea that I would call somebody's reporting was wrong as it always was because I had one Super Soaker rather than three. I mean, I think he's trying to mislead in a very intentional and strategic way. And in that case, I think because he's under so much pressure from Donald Trump, who's angry about the way Spicer is presented on Saturday Night Live, it is reported.
Yeah. To me, the lie word is, you know, if you know that there was or convinced that there was an intent to deceive, that's a lie.
Would you say it on air?
Yeah, and I've said it, and I've just said it.
Yeah.
You know, the other issue, the crowd size was one issue, but the more substantive issue was about the 3 to 5 million people who voted fraudulently, or, you know, illegally. There's no evidence of that. Yeah. Every study that's been done suggests that's just totally inaccurate.
Yeah.
But there's a reason to play it out there.
Right.
If you're Trump and who lost the, you know, popular vote and blah blah, we all know the arguments there. Anyway, sorry, off track, taking question time away. Sarah Pollard asks, where do you expect the U.S. to be 4 years from now? How about 4 days from now?
look, I'm really worried. I'm more worried than I've ever been. I'm more worried than I was after 9/11. I mean, after the 9/11 attacks, I had a lot of personal worries. It's because of the location of where my office was. If you'd asked me a week later, do you think there's a reasonable chance that you personally might be the victim of a car bombing? Yeah, I bought more insurance and we drank all the good wine in the wine cellar. But I didn't think there was any threat to the United States as a whole. I might be unlucky, but the country would be fine sooner or later. This is different. I'm institutionally worried in a way I can't remember ever having been before. But I also have been inspired and encouraged by the way a lot of people are standing up. So I don't want to make a prediction because I think this is a moment where choices that individual people make are going to matter enormously to the outcome.
Jan Levitt asks this. This is a multiple choice question, so you can only pick one. You can't say, well, it's a little bit of all. How important would a bond between Russia... Oh, no, sorry, wrong question. Robert Berry asks this. In your opinion, what's the biggest danger for world peace? China's relationship with its neighbors? Populism in the U.S., India-Pakistan, or Russian expansionism?
I have to choose only one of those.
Well, he wants to know what's the biggest danger. They're all dangerous.
I think the biggest danger to world peace is Russian expansionism. Even though, I mean, an India-Pakistan conflict would probably kill more people, but it would be localized. It wouldn't feel that way if you lived in India or Pakistan, but it's hard to imagine other players coming into that, as terrible as that conflict would be. China is an extremely cautious actor in world affairs. I don't think that they're not a positive actor, they're a negative actor, but they are outstanding calculators of risk. When they meet, they're very good at signaling what they want to do and drawing back when resistance is clear. You can play a very stable game with China. And they are, and their worries above all are focused on maintaining stability at home, where they face potentially revolutionary people. The problem with the Russians is, first, they're bad risk calculators. Second, we're at a particular moment, they are taking a lot of risk right now. They're cheating on arms control treaties. They're moving weapons forward. They talk a lot about nuclear stuff. And we're with them right now in a situation where they are very likely to misunderestimate, borrow a phrase, to miscalculate the likely Western response to things they're going to do. So if you say, how could you get a really broadly nasty situation, I would say that one.
David, there are lots more, but our time for this edition is up. I'm sure we're going to have, I remember back in the Watergate days, where we ended up with a show every night on CBC. This is pre-journal, pre your mom's time on television. Every night, 10:30 at night, Don McNeil, who was our distinguished Washington correspondent, would talk to a number of Washington correspondents. And this went on for, well, like the crisis, for months, trying to analyze the bits and pieces of what had happened each day and try to place them in some context, which you've done wonderfully for us today. And I'm sure we'll have an opportunity to do it again.
Thank
you for your questions. That's it for this Facebook Live.
Thank you very much.